Good morning, everyone. I am Stephanie Van Bart, and I am a small business owner. I want to thank you today for joining us for Just Talking Business. I am very excited about our next guest, as I always am, truth be told. But we have Dr. Anna Etienne, who is with StartUp Miami Food. She is here to talk to us a little bit about the pivot plan for the food and beverage industry. So let's get started. Hello there, Dr. Etienne.
Hi, I am great.
And can I call you Dr. Diana?
You can call me Anna.
I want respect. I want respect. You worked hard to get that doctor.
Yes, yes. No, I'm so happy to be here.
Thank you for agreeing to join us. Who are you and what do you do?
All right. So, hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Anna Etienne, and I am the program director for StartUp FIU Food. And I have a pre and post version of the description of StartUp that COVID has been a marker for. So prior to the pandemic, StartUp FIU Food was solely an incubator, providing access to a commercial kitchen space at the university, access to our incubator program, and also functioned as a membership. So once you participated in the 3 months of the accelerator, you stayed a member. And so we would continue to provide support to those small businesses whenever there was an opportunity to present them to, let's say, a Whole Foods or a Lowe's. We would provide private showcases for them to pitch their products to companies. And, you know, prior to the pandemic, they were doing really great. And also prior to the pandemic, the concept of transitioning online was not something we forced, right? It was a part of our curriculum. It was a part of our, you know, the activities that you learned, but it really was up to you to pull the trigger. We couldn't necessarily say, and you have to. And so once the pandemic happened, the companies that said yes to that online experience tripled in sales. Mm-hmm. The companies that were not comfortable with the concept experienced a 30 to 50% loss in revenue that quarter. And so we had to make changes. Did I know we were going to be in the house for a year? I did not.
Everybody had to figure it out along the way.
But, unfortunately, the losses of revenue and the impact on them, their families and their business caused us to reevaluate how we deliver programming. And so we decided to really focus on helping small businesses diversify how they distribute their product. Absolutely. So let's say you were a farmer's market person and you killed it every weekend, but for whatever reason, you're no longer able to do that, or there are limitations to that. We support you in packaging some of your products and retailing it online, discussing other platforms such as like a GoBelly to figure out, okay, if you were to distribute your product via retail online, or if you were to secure contracts with local grocery stores, because some of our companies, their grocery store contracts save them, right? And so what are some other avenues that you can take on to distribute your product? And so a lot of times people think, okay, doing business online is a Shopify account and a website.
right. And it's not.
It's cultivating a business model for that. And so we've made some changes. Yes, hopefully we'll get back to full normalcy where we can do a lot of face-to-face activities. But for now, we're focused on helping small businesses digitally transform and also transform their products in a way that could be packaged and delivered to their clients wherever they are. And so for those that are interested in making that kind of change and also interested in working on building their own ecosystem, their own village of other small businesses, this is what we would like to do. We want to provide you with the technical assistance mm-hmm. the workshops and support in the process of your transition at your pace. But we also want to introduce you to additional opportunities. And so we can discuss some of that as well.
So good. That's actually going to, it was like, it's funny. I was just about to ask you. So when you talk about a transition, what does that look like? And it seemed like you talked about that. And I actually know some restaurants who were able to save their businesses through doing some, you know, some contract work with grocers. But, you know, sort of as we were talking about before, the food industry has been a very innovative industry for me. Mm-hmm. I'm actually reading a book right now called From Scratch, which was the creation of the Food Network. There's been food trucks. There's been all these very innovative ways that food has become a celebrity in and of itself. Mm-hmm. But I was actually surprised, and I shared with you earlier, how during the pandemic, they were one of the industries that was sort of the slowest to make the shift. Mm-hmm. Do you, one, think that is because there was no awareness out there that's how they should be shifting? Was it just about survival? Was it, you know, about not having the capacity to be able to do so? What mm-hmm. in your understanding, what do you think that was about?
Okay, so depending on where you are in the industry, the food business is not an inexpensive business, right? The overhead alone for a restaurant owner is very high, where mm-hmm. in other companies, you're not having to deal with shelf life for your product. Mm-hmm. Exactly. You're not having to deal with a supply chain that has been impacted by everybody being closed, right? So mm-hmm. remember that scare where there was like, hey, all the prices of these different fruits and these different things are about to skyrocket because
right.
Mm-hmm. we're about to deal with some supply chain issues. And so small businesses specifically experience a greater challenge. And it was, you know, the analogy I used with you earlier during the pandemic, it was the small businesses, Hurricane Andrew. They mm-hmm. were that homestead image of the houses being flattened. Like, man, right. you did all this work, but under this version of pressure that you didn't know existed, it killed what yeah. you were just in the process of building, right? Mm-hmm. And so the actual challenge I'm going to shout is capital. It's access to capital. Mm. It is being in a position to have a reserve. It's a lot of the businesses that survive, they had a few locations. They maybe had to let go of a few locations.
Right.
But those micro businesses, the entrepreneurs that, let's say, they just got themselves to the place where they could hire a few contracted employees. Mm-hmm. They just got a few contracts in a few locations. They paid heavy because those mm-hmm. emergency loans, the first few rounds, they got none of it.
Right.
They got right. none of it.
Right. And is that because they weren't prepared, or is that because?
You know what? It's in my personal opinion, and this is my opinion in the audience. You guys, you tell me how you feel. But I do not believe that the first round of those grants were designed for the actual small business.
I agree.
Right?
I agree.
At least in South Florida, 75% of our small businesses are micro. They mm-hmm. are not the ones mm-hmm. with the multiple locations, right? Mm-hmm. A few companies that have a location, they have a staff of 10, 15 people. Could be categorized as small in comparison to the larger corporations that they're competing with. But a majority of our people are immigrants, mm-hmm. are people of color who are doing it all with the money that they make, right? So mm-hmm. they have multiple jobs.
Right, right. It's all going back into the business.
Selling. Mm-hmm. They're not trying to be Steve Jobs. They're trying to pay the rent. They're trying to create additional streams of income for to maintain. This is right. not an effort to be the next Jeff Bezos. This is an right. effort to support the family. And so I felt like those systems were not designed for them. I don't think those systems were created with them in mind. And uh-huh. the pandemic, I think, really highlighted that. And I've seen some of these organizations make adjustments and changes, because I think like the second or third round of the emergency funds actually reached some of our community members. But that first round was really telling about how, you know, some define small business versus the actual population.
Right. Exactly. And it, like, even when you talk about the ecosystem, did that wake up the ecosystem here? You mentioned in Miami, where we are, 75% of the business is small business. I've sort of felt like the ecosystem was kind of going in one direction, and maybe they had to wake up as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of these programs had to think about, oh, we've got to shift what we're saying to some of these small businesses. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's happening now? Did we get it? Are we getting it? Are we there yet? Well,
I hope so. I'll say this, and this was before the pandemic, because prior to working with FIU, I worked with another organization, and those businesses were a lot larger, but based off of everyone's standard in the United States, they were categorized as small. Mm-hmm. But small is, you know, according to the United States, it's under 2 mil. Right. And so, you know, company grossing, you know, 2 million is categorized as small here. And, you know, at the time, because these were the only companies at the time I was working with, I was like, oh, wow. Yeah, there's lots we can do. Mm-hmm. And helping them develop a growth strategy was different, because they had access to the kind of capital that would allow them to strategize to pivot or scale. Once I started here, and I had the opportunity to work on a program focused on the minority community, the community that is focused on people of color, and man, it was a slap in my face. That I'm saying about these other organizations, I had to have my come to Jesus moment too. I was wrong, right? Because for years I had heard, you know, get them the training, get them the workshops, get them these things, and then they'll be great. We did not factor in the external barriers, right? What does it look like for, you know, a cupcake company to start a business in, let's say, Tampa versus Miami? What is the cost of doing business in Tampa? What is the cost of living in Tampa?
Exactly. Right?
And you know, where can I get my supplies versus in Miami, where this is a hypermarket.
Right, exactly.
Meaning that, you know, we have a lot of dollars being pumped in to our city. And here, you know, our community members are your everyday working class person. Right. That does not have the kind of foreign dollars to just say, I'm going to buy all these different buildings, or I'm going to buy all these different commercial spaces, making the cost of that lease agreement to be $10,000 a month versus maybe $1,000 to $2,000 in another city or state.
Absolutely.
And so these are the things that are not necessarily articulated when the issues or the challenges that small businesses face, they're not factored in. It's just this internal conversation about, you know, making sure you know how to run a business. And don't get me wrong, yes, it is very important. And we are, you know, we create programs that focus on helping you with your marketing, helping you with your finances. What I'm suggesting is that that's not where the support should stop. That is just the beginning.
I agree.
Right? Yes, I'm going to provide you with accelerators and incubators and activities for you to participate. But I challenge you to stay. Let's talk about what you just did. Let's debrief, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what do you want to do after that? How do you want to implement? How realistic is it to implement based on the schedule of your life?
Right.
What kind of help do you think you need? You know, how do we think outside of the box? And so this is where the concept of collaborating and cultivating a village is extremely important. Mm-hmm. It will not be beneficial for you to feel like I have to compete with the rest of the world and I have to do this on my own.
Right, exactly.
And circulate that dollar amongst ourselves as micro businesses. We can help each other grow collectively. And so what I really want to do this year, and we're working on an online platform, is to highlight who is here.
Right.
How do I find a local, and like we were discussing about HR and payroll, how do I find someone who does that locally?
Right.
To support me? How do I find someone to help me with the digital marketing space? Yes, I want to understand and I need to understand what that budget looks like, but who can I get to help me in these other categories that I'm not good at? Because I, truth be told, I just want to focus on
this part of what I do. Mm-hmm. Exactly, because that's what I'm good at. That's what I'm great at. And all of this other stuff is just, I have a friend who's in a food business right now, and she does very, very well. But you know, she's been in this business for 15 years and she's in several grocery stores, which you would think is great, but she's just now realized I can't do this by myself. I'm going to have to unpack and have some people responsible for this and some people responsible for this so I can really focus on the growth. Mm-hmm. But I find sometimes that's a difficult conversation to have and about not only finding an ecosystem that can help support that growth, but you know, when you look at some of our local leaders, mm-hmm. our local officials, having that same conversation of your investment in this can be just, you know, looking at ways to invest in some of these small businesses in a real way. Mm-hmm. And I'll use an example, I think, and I want to see what your opinion is. Miami Beach right now is in the middle of a war between the food and beverage industry and their local leaders. They are trying to reduce the amount of late hours, but according to the industry, this, you know, 2 to 5 and 12 to 5 is when they make their most money. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and this was an area that was founded on this party identity anyway. It's marketed that way, it's branded that way. Now you're trying to flip the script. What are some things that a small business should be thinking about now in order to keep themselves afloat or survive during, you know, if this should come about, and what conversation mm-hmm. should we be having with the elected officials to really have them understand their support is paramount in this situation? Because mm-hmm. they're going to have to pick up the pieces.
I agree. And man, that is a murky, that last part is, I'll start with the first part of the question.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Okay. I think what we all had to learn during the pandemic was the fact that the one way of doing business is not enough, mm-hmm. right? And the cost of doing business within a commercial space where the overhead is extremely high is painful. And I can imagine that in that area, the mm-hmm. just price of being there mm-hmm. is expensive in comparison mm-hmm. to other parts of the city. And so financially, it is painful. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, you can make suggestions. You can't tell someone what to do with their business. I think mm-hmm. what I've experienced the past decade is that, you know, people see their business as their baby. Mm-hmm. And my response is, but we want the business to feed your actual babies, right? And so
we do too.
It's gonna be imperative to diversify your mm-hmm. brand, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of times, you know, in this prior to the Ford version of the 9 to 5, the concept of having multiple streams and doing multiple things was not uncommon. Mm-hmm. And I think we should consider not just opening up your doors, but let's see if we can get some government contracts for some of your packaged items. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we can take some of your packaged rubs, wet or dry, and pitch it to your local grocery stores. Let's talk about the brand, right? Mm-hmm. And how you can diversify the various components of what you create and scaling that. So that way, when one part of the business gets hit, you have two other three parts of the business that's still able to work for you.
Right.
And unfortunately, when it comes to the politics, you as a community, can we really say we have control? Mm-hmm. I mean, I wish we did, but for the most part, a lot of small businesses that don't have an extreme amount of wealth to just solve the problem for them, they are not thinking about that. They are thinking about how am I going to make it for the next month?
Right, exactly.
Lights open. How am I going to provide for my family? And so, you know, as you're addressing your local officials, it's from your positionality of what you're dealing with. But it just so happens that so many people are dealing with what you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. I can't say what local officials should do, but I would love to see efforts of collaboration and, mm-hmm. and opportunities that could be sourced directly to them, right? Mm-hmm. So I know that we're in a situation where we don't know. I feel like we're on the 50th variant of COVID.
When is going?
We don't know. But I think what people care about, what they're concerned about, is knowing that you are present, that you are listening, that you care, and you're making some type of effort to help them, right? Mm-hmm. So, we collaborate all the time with corporations, with city leaders to say, hey, can we help you get these resources to your people directly? Mm-hmm. You know, can we survey them so we can hear from them what they think they need? Mm-hmm. And let's go find that. Let's go find the help that they need. If there needs to be another version of cultivating ways for them to still be open, but maintain whatever it is that that needs to be maintained, let's negotiate. Let's talk about it. Let's collaborate. Because at the end of the day, you know, all parties need each other. But those businesses are, you know, you all need, right? You all need those businesses to survive if you want our community to survive. So mm-hmm. how can we, you know, from the university to local corporations who are living here with us in the city to our government officials, collectively ask, what do you need? Mm-hmm. How can we help you? And I think that would be a more respected approach for the small business to say, hey, you know, this is new for us too, but we want to help, we want to work this out. What can we do? And so that's mm-hmm. what I think, that's what I'm hoping for in rest of 2021 into 2022.
Yeah, I agree. So, okay, let's see, before the pandemic, CNBC said that 60% of food and beverage businesses close in the first year.
Yeah.
80% in the first five. Mm-hmm. So why? I mean, and has the pandemic shined light on that in a way that now makes us say we really need to try to help small businesses do things a little bit differently?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would say it, and this is my personal opinion, I think the cost of doing business in the food industry, specifically in the restaurant space, is expensive. Mm-hmm. And you get a lot of classes in school, but you don't get that class that tells you how much is going to cost mm-hmm. to do X, right? And some people can afford to learn as they go and pay the financial cost. Some people cannot. I've had a few entrepreneurs get really upset with me because, you know, they have their concept, they have their idea, they take the little bit of money that they have and they buy shirts and items, and they spend all the first amount that they have on an idea or concept that hasn't been proven, meaning that you have this idea, you have this concept, but the only way to prove it is on your financial statements. Can you show me quarterly how this has scaled, how you've been double, how you were able to double, triple those numbers, right? Before you, you know, make this extreme financial investment. And so I think that that is a challenge for a lot of our food businesses. It's also, we have a lot of diversity. The concept of doing business in Miami is not the same as doing business in Nassau, right? That farmer's market, flea market experience, or even the ability to get your own store in other countries is just very different than it is here. We have lots and lots and lots of red tape. When it comes to the permitting process and construction costs, it is very expensive. And not having a village to support you and talk you through it and explain to you what those needs are and help you work through your projection so you could really know how much it's going to cost you to do business is also the other pain point, right? And so with a lot of our small businesses, you know, we've sourced pro bono work from attorneys. We have FIU faculty to come in and evaluate the space to say, okay, no, the space has this issues and you should not pay for this space. You need a team, right? And not necessarily saying that you have to have the capital to go hire everyone out. But there is, in my opinion, here locally, a village capable of supporting you develop your forecast so you know how much this is going to cost before you enter the market. And I think ideally, not being a solo artist in your business is the best thing you could do to prevent yourself from having that experience.
That's true. Mm-hmm. So let me tell you one of my theories, especially in this market, as a business owner here, I could be wrong. There are a lot of programs out there. I've done workshops galore. I fully am on board with programmatic programs that support small businesses. I just finished one, actually, the SBA Emerging Leaders, which was great for my business and for my mindset, for me to re-engage in what I'm doing in my business. But there are a lot of programs sort of doing either teaching the same thing or may not be as strong at teaching certain things. And so my theory is, and I've been screaming at the mountaintop, how do we maybe develop some kind of hierarchy of the types of programs that are out there and help these businesses sort of elevate and meet these programs where they are. Is that something we're working on? Do you agree? Do you think, you know, because if I go to one more class that teaches me how to incorporate, I'm going to be I am incorporating. I've been incorporating for a long time. Tell me how to make some money. And so what do you do?
Okay, so I'll say this. Even before the pandemic, I felt that way. And every time a new program would come up, I get a text message saying, ooh, girl, somebody's about to start a program just like yours. I'm like, let them, child. Tell them I said good luck. Because, you know, to me, what I had to learn was that for this demographic, a program is not enough, right? For that category of close to 1 to 2 mil, perfect sense. They could do an accelerator program, design a growth strategy, just like you would design a business plan. A growth strategy is like a strategy on how to expand. Take that document, get their team, go do it, right? They're already in the market. They're trying to scale. Yes, do all of it. Before the population I'm discussing, they are working towards entering
the industry. Okay.
They're trying to get in. And some people may say, I'm already in. I have registered my business. I have these clients. But when my definition of in is financially sustainable, where you don't need any other side hustles. You don't need nothing else. It is on its feet. It is growing. You're in a position to do X, Y, Z, right? And now you have the capital to get your own location, to do your own thing, right? For me, that is different. And for me, I can't just say, take this class, congratulations, here's this piece of paper, have a good time. With this experience, you quickly came to the realization, and this is something that I've discussed with the team at FIU. I'm like, hey, you know, this class is great. I love the fact that we're giving them access to this kitchen. That's nice. But I now know it means 0.01%.
Right.
And walking the process with them has helped me identify that the problem is so much bigger than them,
mm-hmm.
and that the classes can provide them with context and begins the conversation of the things that they'll need to implement on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. But we need to be the pit crew when the car comes in to help them change those tires, right? As they run this race. We can't just say to congratulations, have a nice life.
Mm-hmm.
We need to be the buffet they get to come to every time they need to come to it, right? And so,
and you know, how do we set them up to having their own kitchen?
Exactly.
Now do we are we putting those? You know, it might not be when they walk out the door.
Listen, the pandemic slammed us because, you know, we're a state university.
Mm-hmm.
So when the state closed, our kitchen had to close. This is owned by the state, right?
And so business is closed.
Yeah,
so the kitchen just got shut down.
You know, I spent like a week trying to find kitchens to take some of our people in.
Oh,
it was the ultimate slap in the face. Like, okay, we're helping. And I thought my help was sustainable because I'm helping them get contracts, introducing them to people. I'm thinking, oh, this is good.
If I use not going anywhere.
Yeah, you know, in my mind, I'm like, oh, okay, we're making a difference. This is so good. But then that pandemic hit, and I felt like I felt like a failure. I was like, man, I thought I was helping you build something sustainable, and here comes a hurricane I couldn't predict, and it is killing you, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, taking it all the way up to the macro level, I'm like, man, the process of you transitioning is even harder.
Right.
So that's when I went into, and we talked about this beforehand, researching a lot of towns that were people of color. And I looked into at least like 13 to 16 towns. And their efforts of circulating the dollar was 100% collaborative. It was the collaboration between everyone's business vision that led to their ability to build their own cities and towns. And so, not to say that this is what I'm attempting, but as a small business community, I'm a firm believer that this is something we could collectively do. We can help each other circulate the dollar by helping each other find each other. You know, so yes, I'm dealing with food businesses, but if you are an accounting business, if you're an HR business, if you are a marketing business, let's collaborate, help you collaborate with each other, as our program helps to collaborate with other corporations and organizations to help get you these resources and contracts and marketing attention. Like, we want to shine this light on you, but in order for us to do that, we need to know you exist.
Right.
And we want to introduce the conversation to you as to why. Like, you participate in these workshops and these classes, but the context of why you need it a lot of times is missing, right? You may not need it to be your own accountant. You may need it to understand what your accountant is doing.
Right.
You may not need it to be your own digital marketing expert, but you may need it to be able to interview and articulate what your needs are to a digital marketing expert, right? This is, in my opinion, you know, we're building this online platform because we want to build a forum for us to talk it through, for us to collectively pivot, and for us to collectively find resources that you need today, not this long term. All right, eventually,
10 years down the road,
down the line, I think I'm gonna get it.
If you make it that far.
Right. And so, you know, that's the goal of StartUp. You know, we're doing an accelerator starting next week on the 25th.
Yeah, I'm just
sharing. 3 weeks.
That.
But it's literally, it's a membership. So once you become a member, you get your business advisor, you participate in your classes. And I want those classes to be an opportunity for collaboration and networking.
Mm-hmm.
Come towards the end of fall, we're gonna do our best to highlight everybody that participates, help you design and get that website up so we can say, hey, everybody, look who's already doing this.
Right.
Don't you think you should hire them? let's have activities and events so you can be introduced to this small business. The other thing that
we're doing, is that only for food and beverage or just
email? Well, no, we're working on a directory for everyone because we want everyone to find everyone, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have a marketing company, if you provide some type of HR service, we want to highlight you. We found a fulfillment center in Palm Beach, a young lady who owns her own shipping company. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, okay, great. Cause that way they don't necessarily need Amazon to be able to get that 3-day delivery experience. Right. Mm-hmm. So we want to find all the parts of the supply chain that's going to help you do this. And if you guys can collaborate and work together, I feel like you're all helping each other grow from small to that 2 million that they so love.
And anytime I can get out of that, I'm game for that. I am game for that. So tell us, please, how we can connect with you, how we can connect with you, and how we can connect with the incubator.
Absolutely. So I am going, if Nikki hasn't shared it with you, we'll share a link for the upcoming accelerator, which is 3 weeks, but you automatically become a member of our online Grow Local Biz platform. And this is honestly, this is our efforts to create like the Bruce Beach / Black Wall Street network, right? Like these mm-hmm. other cities where they had all these different small businesses doing business together.
Right.
I want that online. And so our accelerator is to help make sure, and we can identify, okay, where the gaps are. Let's help you, get your website up. We have a partnership with Wix where we're providing every single person a free year of Wix to create and build their website. And we are also providing you with your own advisor. Like there are all these activities to onboard you as a member, but we want you to stay. Let's talk about this. Let's come up with the strategy. And the strategy is, it could be quarter to quarter. It could be moment to moment, and that's okay. The other thing that we're doing, which I'm really excited about, we just partnered with Bank of America. And Bank of America is working on a business holiday village.
And so nice.
For those that want some attention and press, okay? you can, and for those who participate in our accelerator, we're going to give them the opportunity as well. So Bank of America is going to select 10 winners to receive $2,000, to receive a feature in the Herald, and to be featured at their first business holiday village at the Underline, which is in Brickell.
Oh, nice.
So we're providing the boot camps for that. Mm-hmm. But guys, come. We're going to start the boot camps for that next week as well.
Okay.
But this is the online example of what we used to do face to face when the world was normal before, you know, we'd say, okay, we're going to do a private showcase for our members. But now we want to create this type of opportunity mm-hmm. for small businesses online. And so this is like the first effort. And you know, the money is great, but I also want you to get that feature in the Herald. I want you to be able for the Bank of America executives to fall in love with you. Like these are the opportunities that I think could be life-changing for a small business. Okay. We've been able to do it for other businesses before where certain organizations would fall in love with them. And when it was time for them to launch their first location, those corporations were right there to provide seed funding and support. And so really important to not just take our classes, but to get to know the community that's here, to network with the resources that are here mm-hmm. and be in a position to tell us, hey, Anna, this is great, but I also need X.
Right.
Can you create an opportunity for Y? Because here is where your collective voices will help mm-hmm. us go source opportunities and resources for you to help you scale collectively.
That's actually, and that feels like a team. in and of itself. There's your team right there. Well, I thank you so much for doing this and sharing this information with us. I have shared the flyer. Nikki did give it to me. So we've shared the flyer. So with the Bank of America, if you want to share that too, I'll definitely put that out into the world. I'd love to stay connected and hear all about what you're doing. We'd love to share it with our audience here in Miami and beyond.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. This was a wealth of information. I think much of this we can apply to other people's businesses, not just food and beverage. So once again, you have a great day and I thank you and please stay connected.
Thank you, Stephanie. Absolutely. Have a great one, guys.
All right, bye-bye. So thank you for joining us again here at Just Talking Business. We will be back here again on Tuesday at 10 a.m. talking to Conchita Pleasant, who is a hair product designer. Nefertiti is her product. And I've tried it. It's amazing. So you'll have a chance to talk to her next week and ask her questions. Thank you again for joining us. And we will see you soon. Bye-bye.